SBS, a world of difference. You're with NITV Radio, on mobile, online and on radio.
We acknowledge the traditional owners of the land NITV broadcasts from, Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation and their elders, past and present. We also acknowledge all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander tribes and clans we broadcast to, from the mountains to the plains, from the desert to the sea, from freshwater to saltwater.
Yama, and welcome to NITV Radio. Coming up in your program this Monday, July 10, well, a legal expert, Associate Professor Hannah McGlade from Curtin University Law School, will respond to Indigenous Australians Minister Linda Burney's 4 points priorities of the voice to Parliament. We'll also be joined by Emma Gallet, an academic, lawyer and columnist. Together, we'll explore the controversy surrounding the new Aboriginal cultural heritage laws that came into effect on July 1 in WA. Together, we see what the confusion is all about. Also on NITV Radio today, Christina Ngo, one of Australia's veteran musical icons, shares the story of her remarkable journey with Living Black Scholar Grant. Christina Ngo also shares the story of how she's fostering the next generation of artists. All these stories and more coming to you after the latest news on NITV Radio. Bertrand Tungandami Ngaya. I am Bertrand Tungandami.
Australia Day 1972 saw the first Aboriginal embassy erected outside Parliament.
The native title legislation must be amended.
And they've walked this land so many times before anybody came.
I am sorry.
This bulletin, Yuendumu elders to launch a trauma response kit for First Nations families. The Prime Minister secures a $1 billion defence deal with Germany. And calls for Scott Morrison to resign as the Robert Debt Royal Commission fallout continues. Elders from the Yuendumu community or in the Northern Territory have come together to launch a trauma response kit for First Nations families. It uses a storybook, games and cards to explain trauma and its impacts as a response to the intergenerational traumas which are daily challenges for many people living in remote communities. Senior World Prairie women from the Early Childhood Group have spent the past few years talking to their community and developing the Healing the Spirit kit. Member of the group, Ome Kalaga, says the kit will benefit Indigenous families.
So we can help, grow up our kids to be strong, not to see violence. We want Yuendumu to be a peace place. Yeah, we got to grow up kids. We want to take them hunting, teach them cultural way.
The kit will be shared with other World Prairie communities through schools and clinics. Indigenous Australians Minister Linda Burney says the proposed Indigenous Voice to Parliament will be a two-way relationship key to solving long-running issues. As campaigning increases ahead of the referendum, Ms. Burney has told the ABC's Inside Us program the dynamic between government and the proposed body would be based on trust.
The relationship that I want with the Voice is a two-way process, one of respect, one of listening to fresh ideas about intractable problems. It's about making a practical difference to the shocking social justice outcomes for Aboriginal people.
The comments follow an address by Ms. Burney at the National Press Club last week, where she outlined that the Voice would have four main policy areas of health, education, jobs and housing. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese has arrived in Berlin, where he has secured a $1 billion defence deal with Germany. Under the agreement, Australia is set to provide more than 100 Boxer heavy weapon carriers to Germany. The carriers are to be supplied by a Queensland-based military vehicle provider from 2025. Mr. Albanese says it will be one of Australia's largest ever exports and create 1,000 new jobs.
This will boost our sovereignty, this will increase our defence capability and boost our economy. This is a great outcome, and it's the first outcome of quite a few that we have ready to announce tomorrow with our friends here in Germany. And I thank Chancellor Scholz for the very kind invitation to come here to commemorate these agreements.
Comes ahead of the NATO summit in Lithuania. Scott Morrison is facing fresh resignation calls based on his role in Robodebt, as uncovered by a Royal Commission into the government program. The Royal Commission found former coalition ministers, including Mr. Morrison, dismissed or ignored concerns about the legality of the scheme, and Nine Newspapers is now reporting Liberal MP Bridget Archer, among others, is calling for him to step down. Government Services Minister Bill Shorten says the former Prime Minister should be embarrassed by the findings, but it is up to Mr. Morrison to decide if he should quit Parliament. Nationals MP Barnaby Joyce has told the Seven Network he takes the same view.
First of all, it just has a whiff of not being earnest about it. It's a decision that's best made by the person themselves as to what they want to do with their career, not for other people. Otherwise, you always get the inevitable. We tell all the Labor Party members they should leave politics. They tell us that we should all leave politics. You know, there'll be no one left in the place. So that's a decision to be made. But if you're asking for contrition, you don't have to ask me. The interviews I've done already, if people have been hurt, of course we are sorry, of course we learn, and of course we move on.
The Federal Minister for Communications is hailing a new national gambling register as a game changer. Problem gamblers will soon be able to sign up to a national self-exclusion register as part of new betting reform measures. The register, known as BetStop, will be implemented by the federal government from August the 21st. It's a free service and will allow people to voluntarily exclude themselves from online betting companies. Michelle Rowland told the ABC people will be able to stop betting for anywhere between 3 months to a lifetime.
This is a game changer because it means that with one touch, an individual is able to exclude themselves from these forms of online gambling.
The launch of the register next month follows a parliamentary report looking into online gambling reform handed down in June. The report recommended a ban on online betting advertising that would be phased out in over 3 years. The United States Permanent Representative to the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, NATO, says the alliance appreciates the support Australia has shown Ukraine. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese has travelled to Europe for the annual summit in Lithuania, where he, New Zealand Prime Minister Chris Hipkins, and the leaders of Japan and South Korea have been invited to share their views on regional and global security. The two-day summit, starting on Tuesday, will have significant focus on Russia's invasion of Ukraine, and as well as further support the alliance is willing to provide the Ukrainians. U.S. NATO Ambassador Julian Smith, a former National Security Advisor to Joe Biden, told SBS News the alliance is pleased with the military assistance Australia has provided Ukraine.
Australia now is one of the largest non-NATO contributors to Ukraine. So we leave it to each sovereign country to determine the ways in which they want to provide specific capabilities. But we certainly applaud everything that Australia has done to date. We hope more support will be forthcoming in the future.
This comes after the federal government announced last month it will provide a $110 million assistance package to Ukraine. NATO has turned the Lithuanian capital Vilnius into a fortress defended by advanced weaponry ahead of a key summit taking place just 32 kilometers from Russian ally Belarus. The NATO summit is to be attended by United States President Joe Biden and other alliance leaders, as well as non-alliance leaders like Prime Minister Anthony Albanese and Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky. 16 NATO allies have sent a total of about 1,000 troops to safeguard the two-day summit. Many members are also providing advanced air defense systems the Baltic states lack. Lithuanian President Gitanas Nausėda says anything less than these measures would be irresponsible.
These are a totally normal force. Leaders from 40 countries are arriving, including US President Joe Biden and other NATO allied leaders. It would be more than irresponsible to have the sky unprotected. But what is most important to me is that our people are protected after the leaders have left. So in this sense, we still have work to do. But I look forward optimistically.
Back home, a survey of the Australian rental market says renters in Queensland, South Australia and New South Wales are experiencing the most rental pressure nationwide. New South Wales-based researcher Suburb Trends found Queensland is experiencing the highest strain, with rental prices having risen on average by over 16% in the last year, with average rises in South Australia and Western Australia close behind. Analysis looked at other data, including the percentage of advertised rentals, vacancy rates, and the average percentage of income paid towards rent to measure the overall pressure of renting. The Australian Capital Territory and Tasmania were found to have the highest average percentage of advertised rentals and the ACT the highest vacancy rate of any state or territory, suggesting there may be less rental pressure in Australia's capital. A cold front is sweeping through large parts of Australia's southeast, making its way down to Tasmania. The Bureau of Meteorology has issued severe weather warnings for parts of Victoria, New South Wales, the ACT and Tasmania. Winds exceeding 90 kilometres per hour are expected in broad parts of South Australia, Victoria, New South Wales, the ACT and Tasmania. And to sports, Australian cricket captain Pat Cummins says there were a couple of key moments that led to their third test loss to England. England defeated the Australian team by 3 wickets. Mitchell Starc gave an impressive display in taking 5 wickets in 78 balls, dismissing Ben Stokes and John Bairstow after lunch to swing momentum to the Australians. But a winning partnership from England's Harry Brook caught out for 75, and Chris Woakes, who hit the winning runs, gave the Brits exactly what they needed. Cummins told Sky Sports Cricket there were some missed opportunities.
Unfortunately, lost a couple of wickets, which happened. So, I thought to get up to 250 gave us something pretty competitive to bowl at, but wasn't quite enough.
And now having a look at the weather around the country this Monday afternoon: Broome, sunny 28, Perth, partly cloudy 20, Adelaide, a shower 2:16, Melbourne, partly cloudy 16, Hobart, a shower 2:15, Albury, Wodonga, cloudy 11, Canberra, partly cloudy 13, Wollongong, sunny 19, Sydney, sunny 20, Newcastle, wind easing, sunny 20, Brisbane, sunny 22, Townsville, partly cloudy 25, Cairns, partly cloudy 27, Alice Springs, sunny day 19, Darwin, also sunny 33 degrees, and the Torres Strait Islands, cloudy day ahead and a top of 29 degrees. And that is NITV Radio News.
NITV Radio, Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 1 p.m. or anytime online.
Emma Galette, an academic, lawyer and columnist, is joining us on NITV Radio to explore Western Australia's new Aboriginal Cultural Heritage Act that came into effect on July 1, triggering some mixed reactions, with some pundits even pouring into outright scaremongering. Emma Galette, first of all, thanks for joining us on NITV Radio. And before we look at the reactions to the new laws, can you explain to us the fundamentals of WA's cultural heritage laws, the ones that just came into effect?
Yeah, so the new Cultural Heritage Act came into force on the 1st of July. So that was just last week. And what it does is it replaces the old and outdated 1972 Cultural Heritage Act. And the reason they needed to amend and replace the Act was because the old Act didn't provide traditional owners with adequate procedural fairness in decision-making on their land. So procedural fairness means having being able to have opportunity to have input and show evidence to make a decision. So what the new Act does is it aims to better protect Australia's 60,000 years of Aboriginal heritage. The new law wasn't just created really quickly. In fact, it was developed over 5 years and involved extensive consultation with a variety of stakeholders over WA. It really aims to fairly balance the interests of different land users and stakeholders, which does include Indigenous people, and it includes stronger protections for significant sites and broader definitions of what Aboriginal cultural heritage is. So this is really important. And it also includes a positive duty to exercise due diligence. So what that means is you need to actively avoid harm to Aboriginal heritage. And if you don't, there are, in fact, stronger penalties for breaking the law, which is really important because we need to protect our Aboriginal heritage. The new law also considers something called cultural landscapes, which is great because it's not just individual cultural sites, and it includes both tangible and intangible cultural heritage. It means we can protect that, which is very, very significant for Aboriginal people and a big improvement from the last 1972 Cultural Heritage Act.
Yeah, you said it tries to address the concerns of many stakeholders, but is it a good law?
I think it is. It's a big improvement from the last Act. The aim of it is to really to better reflect aspirations of Aboriginal people into government and business decisions. But because unfortunately the views of Indigenous people haven't been given equal weight in WA before, and unfortunately because of that we've had incidents in the past where Aboriginal heritage has been legally destroyed, but it may not reflect what the community and Indigenous aspirations are for that site. So it is an improvement on the old law, but there are still some things that could have been done to improve it, and that includes avenues for protecting sites from cumulative effects as well. And one thing I would have liked to see as well is a federal legislation, but I can talk to you a bit more about that a bit later.
Yeah, we'll definitely continue this conversation. But coming back to the stakeholders, and one Shire in particular, the Shire of Carnarvon, says that the new law may trigger community disputes about who is the appropriate traditional owner or knowledge holding group for a particular area of land. And yeah, this is an issue that seems to not have been adequately addressed by the new law.
This has been an ongoing issue. It's something that's not new. So I think that a lot of stakeholders that might have had this issue in the past, they're raising it again and it's rearing its head. But it's always been an issue for some stakeholder groups in identifying who the Indigenous knowledge holders are. And it's up to them as well to do their due diligence and make sure that they consult with the right groups as well. I hope that the new law is able to support this and make sure that traditional owners are consulted in the adequate and correct way to protect their Aboriginal heritage.
Some believe the law has been a little bit rushed. Why now?
The reason for it now is because we had really outdated laws previously. We had the Aboriginal Heritage Act in 1972. It was created and it failed to protect significant sites, and a lot of our sites were legally destroyed. And I'm not saying that might not happen with the new Act, but what the new Act does is it allows for more procedural fairness so that decisions made are more representative of state bodies. What the new Act does is to try and mitigate some of those failings of the past law, and it demonstrates the need for legal reform from the past. So that's what's occurred now. We have new laws which can try and prevent disasters happening in the past.
Yeah, I've been sifting through the comments. There are some that say that while the new law may be a step in the right direction, it actually does not go far enough from an Indigenous perspective. especially for this is, comes from professionals who look at it and work in the Indigenous community.
Yeah, and I think that it would have been nice to see a right of appeal in there as well for decisions for Aboriginal people. But one thing that is called for is, for example, the First Nations Heritage Protection Alliance. They've called for overarching federal legislation to ensure that Aboriginal self-determination and consent rights on cultural heritage are codified into Commonwealth law. And another important point to note as well is that all states have different cultural heritage laws. Currently, there's no national overarching cultural heritage laws. So what is being asked is really important, because what different law in different states and territories means is that there's different levels of protection or participation of traditional owner groups in the management of their cultural heritage. So it would be nice to really make sure that it's protected at the same level across the country and increase the protection of it as well, so that we can start protecting Aboriginal heritage in the same way that non-Indigenous heritage is protected in both the state and in the country. So I really support the call for federal cultural heritage legislation in the future.
Yeah, you kind of touched on what was going to be my next question, is whether this law is unique to WA or other states have their own legislations. But can you maybe tell us one of the key benefits of the WA law compared to other what's applicable in other states and some of the weaknesses?
I would like to say that the new law in Western Australia is just a lot better than our previous Cultural Heritage Act in terms of procedural fairness, as I mentioned earlier. And it's important and it's great. And another good part of it is we now have local Aboriginal advisory, cultural heritage advisory services, which will be established as well. So I really do like that. But one thing we need to make sure of is that those services are resourced adequately and that they have the right people that are able to run them as well, and they're also funded in the right way. If you just compare that with non-Indigenous heritage groups that are funded, you can see that a lot of those, that I just like to see that Aboriginal heritage be recognised in the same way.
Yeah, it comes a little bit too late for some really interesting and very, not just interesting, but actually culturally significant sites that have been destroyed.
Yeah, I would have really liked to see stronger legal protections in the past. And it does come really late, but at the end of the day, the law has changed and there's so much room for law reform in the state and in the country. And I hope that we can continue to make sure that laws are fair, equitable and provide justice for First Nations people, especially when it's concerning decisions over their land and waterways and air.
Emma Garrett, thank you very much for joining us on NITV Radio to further explain to us the reach and implications of the new WA Cultural Heritage Laws.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
You're with NITV Radio.
Now time for a break. And when we come back, a story shared with us by Living Black, NITV's Living Black program, with Christina Noo in conversation with Living Black host Carla Grant. Stay tuned.
Join the conversation on radio, online and mobile. You're with NITV Radio.
Welcome back. Now, Christina Noo is one of Australia's veteran musical icons. She performed at the 2000 Olympic Games at Uluru for NITV's 10th anniversary. And she also hosts weekend evenings on ABC Radio. Recently, Christine shared the story of her remarkable journey with Living Black's Carla Grant.
Christine Arnoux is one of our most well-known singers, having performed internationally and across the nation, including at the 2000 Sydney Olympic Games. But how did this Saibai Mabiyorg woman from the Torres Strait make it to stardom? It's a captivating story.
Kulbaya daye, kulbaya daye, kulbaya daya karya ya ku.
Hi, I'm Christine Arnoux, and my mob is Saibai Island, Sui, Baidam, and Samu.
por caso rulgut pali mai signagin kangai gapalgin.
I am a Torres Strait Islander woman born in Cairns. Most Torres Strait Islanders, if there's, I don't know, for some reason, no beds left on Thursday Island Hospital, you go down to Cairns Base Hospital. I think I've lived down south longer than I've lived in the far north, and you know what? Get back up to the far north and I've got to acclimatise all over again. It's too hot. But I loved it. The tropics, it's always about the colour, the fruit, mangoes. Some of the happiest memories from my childhood are the carefree. We didn't have traditional play equipment that kids, you know, grow up with in the urban cities. And so our ocean was the backyard and the hills and the bush all, you know, out all day. That's what mum and aunties all insisted. Get out of the house, go and play. And then we'd come back when the sun goes down. And my mum used to say, just like birds do, they return to their nest when the sun goes down. And that's what I remember it was like, you know, the fondest memories. Climbing trees, not being able to get back down again, that's a bit scary. But swimming and fishing, and just lots of family. I do remember the first time I ever wanted to perform. I would have had to have been 7 years old, and that was because on a Sunday evening, the family would sit around, we'd watch Young Talent Time. This is when we were still in Brisbane before we moved up north into the Torres Strait. And little Tina Arena just joined the Young Talent Time team, and she was just amazing. And I think that was the moment that I thought, you know, I think I want to perform as well. That was the moment that I think set the tone for how I would go about my life, trying to obtain a career that would be singing to people, making music, and just sharing the love of music and bringing everybody together. How did a young Torres Strait Islander woman get voted off the island and make her way all the way down to Sydney? See, I think, one, you're so remote, and all you dream about every day is finding a way to be in places where other children would have more opportunity or are having more opportunity than you are on an island that's so remote, in a community that's so far away, that you might be off everyone's radar. So you're constantly thinking about how that would happen and when that would happen. And that's exactly what happens when you go to boarding school. From one stepping stone comes another one, and then onto another one, and then onto another one. You meet the right teachers. Educators can be and play one of the most important roles in your life, and that is guiding you and pointing you in a direction that might lead you to something bigger and better. I was very fortunate to be surrounded by teachers and educators who really had our, you know, because it was all of us ATSI kids, had our, you know, future at heart, you know. So I was glad to be introduced to people who pointed me in the right direction. And then I ended up in Sydney because of those connections, and still to this day very grateful for it. I studied dance at NASDA, and I guess from that time that I was seven and I knew that's what I wanted to do, I wanted to be a performer. My knowledge was that it's not what you know, it's who you know in the business. And I just did not know, well, my parents certainly didn't. And I had a long way to come, flying from, you know, remote island community all the way down to the city. And how would I connect the dots from boarding school to that next stage? Enter Troy Doyle, the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander liaison officer. He's a career advisor. He gets an application out when he says that, what is it that you want to do? I said, I want to be in the performing arts. I want to sing. I want to sing, dance, whatever that is. And he pointed out NASDA. He said, you know, I think it might be for you. You're 17 and you can absolutely, you know, stick this out. It's a 5-year course. I'm like, whoa. the main thing that attracted me was I'd learn all of these styles of modern and contemporary dance, even folk. But there was a big focus on Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander cultural dances and performances. Very, very attractive, very, very appealing. And I felt it was really important in shaping that performer that I sort of visualised I was going to become one day. And I stuck it out. And that's my message to all young people out there. Finish what you start. It might turn dull, or it might, for whatever reason, become disheartening, but it's a means to an end. You should always stick it out. Take one day at a time, one day at a time, one foot in the other, and you'll get to your goals. But stick it out, and good things will come at the end of it. I promise you, it happened for me. How did my collaboration come about with Neil Murray and the Rainmakers? During my fifth and final year at NASDAR, we were doing our annual May workshop, and that sort of is when the school opens up the doors to the public. So it's not just the people who subscribe to the school, but also to anybody who they want to bring along, friends of NASDAR, basically. And Neil was apparently invited along as a friend of NASDAR, and we were doing the cultural dances of Yam Island at the workshop. Neil was there, and he's really impressed, and he said, "Who's the little girl with the big voice?" And, you know, look, I'm looking for a female backing singer. We're just a bunch of blokes, and we don't really sing that great. Ask her if she wants to come and try out. So we sat at his home in Annandale on his porch for 2 weeks learning all of the Neil Murray repertoire, including My Island Home. And he said, "Great, you're ready." So my first gig in May, June, was at the Sylvania Water Hotel in Sydney. And one gig turned into two, three, four, and 8 months later I'm graduating, and I've met all of Neil's record company associates who have secretly come and watched me do my annual performance at the Belvoir Street Theatre. And Mushroom Records whips me up, and I sign with Mushroom Records. Join Bangarra the next year, do a gig with Yothu Yindi, and, you know, things just picked up on momentum, and before you know it, it was getting away from me. All of these wonderful opportunities were happening. Doing gigs, being around and associated with people in the music industry was my rock school, because I didn't have any formal music training. I was learning everything on the fly, meaning every time I turned up to a gig, I'd be in a room in a small backstage area of a pub with all just men and being the only female, listening to male banter, trying to work out how I can find my own space as a young woman, a young black woman, in this environment that I really felt like a fish out of water in. So I had to learn, you know, the paces, work out how and where and why I fit in. So I worked very, very, very hard. I paid a lot of attention with my ears, because obviously I'm learning the music by ear, listening to all of the conversations, really listening hard at how people are conducting themselves. I affectionately termed it as my rock school. Sometimes I'm still going through it, because this next generation that's coming through, I'm the old girl now, and they're asking me the questions, and I'm still like, no, I don't know, I'm still learning myself.
And my island home. My island home is waiting for me.
I knew from back in the Rainmaker days, when Neil originally said, "Christine, you should sing the song. It needs a fresh context. It needs a fresh perspective. It needs a fresh voice. And a new life of its own." And songs do that, you know. Songs really have a life of their own after you've performed it. And when I started performing it in the pub, I just was really scared that people would go, "That's not your song, that's the rumpy song, and you've got no right singing it, and you're ruining it.
You know, those were my fears. I was really, really scared. So I didn't sing it for a long time. I sang songs of Neil's that were other songs that people didn't know that well, like Ocean of Regret. And then slowly but surely, I inched my way into My Island Home. Michael Gudinski said, brilliant. That's absolutely brilliant. This is the album. And it became the cornerstone song that informed the direction of the entire album, at which point the culmination of my 5 years of study was making sense. It was all going to be my cultural studies and my passion for my culture and wanting to share that with them, sharing my language. All of that would be what I could just inject into this album. It was there. It was ready made. I just didn't know it.
And that was Christina Nu in conversation with Living Black's Carla Grant. Now, this version of Living Black has been edited for radio by NITV Radio's Sharka Pekova. And you can watch the full episode on SBS On Demand. Let's now have a listen to the track that really marked the beginning. Actually, they just catapulted Christina Nu on the musical scene. And that's all for NITV Radio this Monday afternoon. The program will be back on Wednesday, and it will be brought to you by Luana Grant. I'm Bertrand Tungandame, thanking you for your company this Monday afternoon. Till next time, bye for now. Yaloo.